the last presentation for today by Dr. S.S. Nivalkar, Director of Merck Labs, titled Comparison and Interpretation of Results by Lane Ion Constant Volume and GC Method, supported by demonstrations. Dr. Nivalkar.
In the last presentation, we have seen that there is a lot of lab-to-lab variation or even in inter-lab variation in the analysis of molasses. So first, we'll see what are the crucial points or we have to take into consideration while analyzing the samples via titration method. So number one is method selection, which method you are using for analysis of molasses. In our day-to-day laboratory work, we are following titrimetric method, Lane Ion method, or ICOMSA has also given Luff and Stuhl method also. When I visit factory, there are a lot of discussion with the analyst about which method is to be used for molasses analysis, because many sugar factories nowadays, they are having spectrophotometers. So whether the colorimetric method, that is a DNSA method, can be used for molasses, because they are using it for clear juice analysis or milk juice analysis. But as in case of molasses analysis, we have to take or we have to make a lot of dilutions, because in spectrophotometric analysis, you get results in ppm, milligrams per liter or milligrams per kg. So you have to dilute the molasses samples, and dilution error is much more. Therefore, it is not recommended to use spectrophotometric methods in the sugar factory laboratories. In case of Lane Ion method, it is important in molasses trading that methods of analysis that will give reproducible results. This reproducible result is very important. It is essential that laboratories to maintain standard conditions and follow each analytical step as per the method. I have seen that people, they are using this Lane Ion method, but they are omitting some step, they are modifying some steps, and they are not following each step as per the ICOMSA method. Disagreement between laboratories using same analytical method, labs are using same analytical method, having different results. And why this disagreement? Because they are differencing in details in their procedure. They are not following the procedures exactly given as per the method. This method, ICOMSA GS437 method, it gives more reproducible results under standard condition. This under standard condition is very important here. What conditions you are maintaining at the time of analysis. This method was first modified by United Molasses, and then ICOMSA made this method as an official reference method. What is official reference method? Because when you are when method there are different types of methods are available in ICOMSA method book. One referral method is recommended by ICOMSA. So in case of any dispute, you have to use the only referral method for the analysis. While developing this method by United Molasses, they have given more stress on the inversion process in this method. What are the inversion conditions? This is a critical step in the method, as under conditions of high acidity and high temperature, sugar may get destroyed. This inversion is very delicate process. If it is not properly done, there are chances that sucrose may remain in the solution. It will not get 100% inverted. Or if it is subjected to higher acidity or higher temperature for inversion, there are chances that sugar may get destroyed. Disagreement between laboratories have often been found due to differing methods of inversion. Sometimes I have found that people, they are using concentrated acid for inversion, or they are not controlling the temperature at the time of inversion. The recommended hydrolysis conditions in this method are chosen with care to avoid destruction, and therefore this method gives more reproducible results. Now, when sample preparation, we are not doing sampling, but when we receive samples at our laboratories, these most of the samples we receive in plastic bottles with narrow neck. It is necessary to pour the molasses in suitable container and cut off the bottom of the bottle. Any deposit which is settled at the bottom is taken out and it is added in the molasses and it is properly mixed with glass or wooden rod. Homogeneous and representative sample is a basic requirement of this method, because we are taking only 10 grams of sample is taken for the analysis. So it should be homogeneous and representative. As for the method for weighing the sample, the balance accuracy is important. Balance should be readable to 1 milligram accuracy, because in calculation we are taking the weight of the molasses taken for the analysis. Usually sample quantity taken is 10 gram for our C heavy molasses, and as B heavy contains more sugar, about 8 grams of B heavy molasses taken, 8 plus minus 0.2 gram. For accuracy of results, the preferred molasses quantity is taken in such a way that the final titer value is nearer to 40 ml. Then heating arrangement, this is also very important here. Heating arrangement at the required for the titration. Absence of standard heating condition result in values that are not reproducible from day to day. Means today, if I get result 50.1%, tomorrow I may not get it 50.1%. It may be different, because the heating arrangement, today's heating conditions, they are different. Tomorrow's heating conditions, they are different. Therefore, heating to be arranged in such a way that 75 ml water in 400 ml plus will reach boiling from 20 degrees centigrade in exactly 2.5 minutes. Distance of heating flame and flask base, they are adjusted in such a way that the water boils in 2.5 minutes. Boiling point, when to consider the boiling? Boiling starts after, say, about 2 minutes. But when the steam of bubbles break uniformly over the water surface, then boiling time starts. Now, this end point of this titration is very, very tricky endpoint. So get exactly endpoint, you should provide the daylight fluorescent lamp of sufficient intensity for viewing this color change. And white background in the laboratory helps in detecting the color change. 75 of this. Then in this method, we are using different types of polymetric glassware for taking the filling solution or for taking the molasses samples. All these volumetric glassware should be calibrated. Volumetric pipettes are to be used, not the graduated pipettes. 20 ml volumetric pipette is used for taking the filling solution. 25 ml volumetric pipette for taking the molasses solution. Then we are using different volumetric flasks also, 200 ml volumetric flask and 250 ml volumetric flask for diluting the molasses samples. And 50 ml burette is used for titration purpose. So all these glassware should be calibrated before use. Then timing is important. Usually, in case of titrimetric analysis, we are not worried about the timing. But here, the timing is very, very important. In this titration, timing is very important. Maintenance of precise timing during analysis, that is, time for 75 ml water to boil from 20 degrees centigrade should be 2 minutes and 30 seconds. Then boiling time for molasses and filling solution, means after addition of molasses in filling solution, the mixture should be boiled exactly for 2 minutes. Then titration completion after addition of indicator should be within 1 minute plus minus 5 seconds only. So total boiling time of this titration is 3 minutes plus minus 5 seconds. Then while preparing the filling solution, you have to take some care also. The filling solution should be prepared in sufficient quantity by pouring filling A into filling B while stirring the solution with glass rod. For regular analysis, it is advisable to prepare large batch and allow it to stand for few days before standardizing the filling solution. What we do, we usually take 10 ml of filling A and 10 ml of filling B at the time of titration and mix it, but this adds to error. Then after preparation of filling solution, it should be standardized. It is standardized with neutral standard inert solution prepared exactly as per the method. and we have standardized the solution. We have checked this standard invert solution given by GC method in the presentation by Dr. Sai. You must have seen the two peaks before the inversion of the sucrose solution and after inversion. After inversion, there was not any trace of the sucrose in the invert solution. So that invert solution we took for standardization. Then concentration of failing solution is to be adjusted with addition of copper sulfate or distilled water to give tighter exact 40 ml. Exact, if you are not, you are getting less than 40 ml, you have to add copper sulfate. And if titer is more than 40 ml, you have to dilute it with distilled water. In this method, there is no provision for using failing correction factor. Failing correction factor should be one only. Then how to invert the small acid solution? Inversion is by addition of 6.34 molar HCl solution. And after addition of this acid, solution is gently agitated to prevent local acid concentration. Then this solution is immersed in water bath at exactly 60 degrees centigrade. It is swirled for 3 minutes and followed by it is allowed to stand for 12 minutes. Here care is taken to avoid direct contact of the flask with the heater. Then after inversion of the solution, it is immediately cooled under running water and neutralized with two normal NaOH. Now this acid is also concentrated, so you have to add it slowly and gentle agitation is required while adding this alkali solution. Now as you know that our molasses contain lot of calcium, so some non-sugars in particular calcium can influence the results possibly by forming a complex with glucose and fructose, and this effect should be eliminated by sequestering the calcium in the solution by addition of sodium salt of EDTA. Now coming to the sample titration, before getting the results, you have to carry out the titration 3 times. Every time you have to take 20 ml of failing solution, and first you have to carry out the preliminary test T1, that is failing solution, 20 ml of falling solution and 20 ml of hydrolyzed molasses added, and then the solution is titrated. Titration number 2 is T2 is failing solution 20 ml plus T1 minus 2 ml of hydrolyzed molasses. Means suppose your first titration reading is say 38 ml, you have to take 36 ml failing solution plus 36 ml of hydrolyzed molasses plus water to give volume 73 ml. And the last titration, that is T3, is take 20 ml of failing solution and then add T2 minus 0.5 ml of hydrolyzed molasses. Suppose your T2 is say 39.5 ml, you have to add 39 ml of hydrolyzed molasses plus 20 ml of failing solution and water to make the final volume to 74.5 ml. These are titration conditions. After mixing failing solution and molasses solution, allow solution to boil for 2 minutes, then add 4 drops of indicator, and then proceed with the addition of molasses solution from burette. Titration should be completed at the end of further 1 minute plus minus 5 seconds. And end point is disappearance of blue color, and the solution will get the color imparted by the precipitate of sucrose oxide. Another important care you have to take that at no time flask to be removed from the heater or it should not be shaken. These are calculations. Percent total reducing sugars as invert sugar is equal to 1000 divided by C into T, where concentration C is concentration of molasses per gram of 100 ml, grams per 100 ml, and T is titer 3, which we obtain from the burette. Precision of this method, absolute difference between two results under repeatability conditions should not be greater than 1.51. Means interlaboratory precision should be 1.51% DRS, and under reproducibility conditions, that is intra-laboratory. When you send samples to 2-3 laboratories, their difference should not be greater than 2.41% of TRS. Then apart from the TRS, in addition to TRS, for evaluating the quality of B-heavy syrup and juice analysis, following parameters will be useful. Because as mentioned by Rajesh also, that various impurities or various constituents of the molasses, they are having a direct effect on the fermentation of the molasses. As we are having a lot of data for the molasses, because final molasses, as we are using for years. But as these products, B-heavy molasses, syrup, and juice, they are new to us for fermentation purpose. This should be analyzed apart from TRS or sludge content, because we have found that in B-heavy, the sludge content will be less. Sedimentation test, then calcium content, unfermentable reducing substances, yeast growth, alcohol fermentation yield, and glucose, fructose, and sucrose analysis by GC method. These are important quality parameters when we are using B-heavy or syrup for our fermentation purpose. Now coming to the comparison of GC and Len Yang method for different parameters, we analyze two samples of molasses by titration method as well as by GC method. What we found that by traditional or by Len Yang method, in sample number one, TRS was 51. RS 13.08, unfermentable substances, not sugars, unfermentable substances was 4.67%. So when we subtract this RS and unfermentable substance, it is 8.41%. And when we subtract TRS minus unfermentable substance, it is 46.31%. We usually call it fermentable sugar. And sucrose by TRS minus RS into 0.95 factor, it is 36.03%. So these results we get with our traditional analysis. But when we analyze same sample with previous one.
Okay.
You will find that by GC method, sucrose is 37.96%. And here we are getting by titration about 36%, so almost 2% higher sucrose. Then glucose 3.02%, fructose 6.9%. So sum of this sucrose, glucose, and fructose is 47.96%, and fermentable sugar by titration method, they are 46.34%. So that proves that these fermentable sugars, they are nothing but glucose, fructose, and sucrose. Glucose plus fructose by GC method is 9.30%, whereas this RS percent is 12.55%. So you will find there is a difference of almost 3% by titration as well as by GC method. So why this difference? This difference is mainly due to the unfermentable sugars. Here they are 4.26 unfermentable sugar, but actually glucose plus fructose is only 9.30%. Here glucose plus fructose 9.92%, reducing sugars, they are 13.0%. So when these reducing sugars are almost 9%, in case of titration, we are measuring them as 13% or 12.5%. So these are not actually reducing sugars, these are reducing substances. Now this difference is more in case of final molasses. In case of B-heavy molasses or in case of syrup, the difference is less. In case of clear juice, we have found that the RS content by titration method and glucose plus fructose content by GC method, they are almost same. But this difference is more, almost 4 to 5% difference is there in case of this GC method, in case of final molasses by GC method. So this was regarding this comparison of different GC method as well as by titration method. Thank you.
Sir, there is a question from Dr. Vishnu Prabhakar Srivastava from NSI.
That is what is the standard deviation of difference between the results of sucrose determination by traditional method and GC method?
Standard deviation. Hello, Sai, can you answer this? What is standard deviation? Actually, so far, I think we have not calculated the standard deviation between these two methods.
Yeah, we haven't. I read that question. We haven't calculated the standard deviation, but we will take a look at that reference he's talking about and get back to you.
Okay. And ma'am, there is another question, that is, during analysis of molasses in GC, can we dilute it or use as such? Please clarify.
Yeah, you can dilute it as long as you know the dilution factor. You can definitely dilute your samples. We have done that too. Because taking sample as is also, taking your sample as is cumbersome sometimes.
Okay.
And so we have done experiments where we have diluted molasses 5 times and 10 times. And then taken it as is in the same batch also, and the results match.
Okay. And another question is it possible to determine the unfermentable portions by GC method?
No, because as in unfermentable, as in if there is any leftover sugar, only that can be seen by GC if the fermentation is not complete. The unfermentable part, whatever it is that interferes in the analysis, cannot be seen by GC.
If it is unfermentable sugar, it can be detected by GC, but it is an unfermentable substance that cannot be.
Yeah, that's what I meant.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.